on your mark, ready, set, let's go. Dance floor pro, I know, you know, I go psycho when my new joint hit. Just can't sit, gotta get jiggy with it. That's it, now honey, honey, come ride. DKNY, all up in my eye. You got a Prada bag with a lot of stuff in it. Give it to your friend, let's spin. Everybody looking at me, glancing at the kid.
Welcome to the SSE Forum Live. I would get jiggy with it, but I'm a white guy. My dancing skills, not so great. But hey, Jaye, what's going on, my friend, over in the UK?
I've seen you dance. I've got videos of you wearing flashy glasses dancing, so you can definitely get your jig on. So that's the plan next time I see you. You're going to make me eat pineapple pizza, and I'm going to get you dancing again.
Oh, my gosh. You might want to break out some polka music and some beer. That's usually when it happens.
It's good to see you again. It was likewise. A long weekend here, and we talked, and you laughed at me off camera when I asked if you do Easter. In the US, I actually meant you get Easter holidays rather than do you do Easter. But yeah, I'm just back after a nice Easter break. I went hiking up in what we call the Peak District in Derbyshire. I got in about, I guess, 30 or 40 miles. It was really nice. Really nice weather. Good to get out in the hills. And I know you've been away. What did you get up to?
Yeah, so we had spring break here in the US, and I took the girls out to Orlando. So we spent, oh my gosh, we went to Disney World, multiple parks there, and then spent some time over at Universal Studios. So kids had a great time. Top ride attraction was Tron, which is a new ride in Disney World, or Magic Kingdom, as they call it in Orlando. Definitely recommend it. But then I did partake in a few of the awesome coasters over at Universal, particularly the, I think it's called Veloso Raptor or whatever it was, which was, if you have an opportunity to go to that park, stand in line, it's worth it. You know, when you have to go through a metal detector, that this ride is going to be off the hook good, and it didn't disappoint.
I haven't been over to Disney for a while, and I love roller coasters, so maybe I'll take that advice and do that.
This one's at Orlando Universal. So why don't we talk a little bit about what the SSE Forum is?
You want to give
the overview?
So SSE Forum started, I guess, more than 2 years ago now. A bit of background. We both came out of industry. Obviously, we've both looked after networking and security teams, and really the SSE Forum started because we wanted to bring our peers together, people from in the industry, to talk about what SSE is and where it's going. And really, I guess we branched out on top of that. And it's really, we now bring people in to talk about all things cyber. And on the back of that, the Edge, the podcast was born, really started initially to introduce ourselves and then to go on a journey around what Zero Trust was and what it is and how it fits into today. So now I think we're up to 80 plus episodes now of The Edge. So feel free to give us a look on Spotify and Apple, etc. But we've met a lot of really good friends, I think, through the forum. And it's definitely a place that we still bring people together and have those discussions. And specifically one that I know that we're getting together at RSA. So maybe you can tell people about that.
Yeah. So RSA, if you're attending RSA, reach out to us. We'd love to have a conversation with you, maybe a cup of coffee, maybe one of those adult beverages or just a handshake or whatever it may be. We love interacting with people, getting your opinions on where technology is going, what is top of mind in your world. So feel free to reach out to us. We're available on LinkedIn or hit us up on the website. But we also have some fun that we're doing at RSA and supporting some great causes. So our good friend of the show, Chase Cunningham, agreed to come to RSA, but he had some conditions, and we need to do some work in order to get him there. So Jaye, what is those conditions?
Well, I think our condition was he had to walk around outside the Moscone dressed as a wrestler. I was amazed that he said yes to that, but his conditions are that we need to really help him raise $5,000 for veterans. I see that Simon's dropped it in the chat. So he's agreed to come and join us, walk around outside the Moscone, discuss Zero Trust with people dressed as a wrestler, If we can help raise $5,000 for veterans, which I think is a great cause. I think we're just over $2,000 mark. So if listeners and viewers of this show, even if everyone just computed gave a dollar, gave $2, I think we'd hit our target, and we will video it. We will take photos. And I think it's really good. Like John said, it's really having a bit of fun and bringing people together, right?
Yeah, it's a good cause. This is one that Chase chose. He's got several friends that are part of this organization. I think the guy running it is ex-SEAL Team 6. So it's legit and a great cause. My father was a veteran, so I grew up around the military. So it's a cause that's near and dear to my heart. So please, if you have an opportunity, donate. And if you're going to be at RSA, donate again and come by, and we'll announce on LinkedIn where Chase will be. If we raise it, he will come. We'll let you know so you can get a photo and have some fun with Chase. So we're really looking forward to that. All right, so let's get on with it. Let's get swiggy with it and bring on our guests, and let's dive into what a swig is. All right, we got the power panel here. Darren Tidwell, Ryan Matthews, Alex Hobson. Gentlemen, you want to start with your introductions? Why don't we go first with you, Darren?
Darren Tidwell. I actually work as a solutions architect right now at HPE, has acquired Axis. But I've been in the industry, over 2 decades. I got my start on the customer side. Large scale enterprise, Sun Microsystems was sort of where I grew up, a plug out there for all the Sun alumni. And then I eventually came to Oracle, and then that's where I came over to the dark side and eventually wound my way over here to meet you two guys.
And if you don't know, Darren's got an amazing lightboard video out there. Go search for it. Is it available on YouTube? It's outstanding. Alex, how about you? What was your journey?
Yeah, I started in distribution back in 2004, working various different roles to eventually I fell into a sales engineer role in 2009. And then, worked with our distributor for a number of years, and then worked for a partner back to distribution. And now I'm at HPE, working as sales engineer.
Nice.
So a bit of a mix.
And Ryan Matthews, my cousin here in the Pacific Northwest.
I have been in the industry very long. That's how all the gray got in my beard. But relevant to this discussion, I spent around 3 years at Zscaler and then joined the Axis team just as we were being acquired by HPE. So I've got a lot of experience in the SSE space specifically.
Nice. So esteemed panel, let's dive into it. How did we get here? What is the history of this technology that we now know as the SWG? Where did it start? And let's dive into that. Why? What is the reason for it?
Do you want me to go? I mean, I'd love to.
Yeah, man, you can start. I know you're never at a loss for words. So.
You're not going to be able to hold me back, right? So, I mean,
you guys were in industry. I forgot.
So, I mean, for me, Secure Web Gateway goes right back to the birth of the internet, right? I mean, the internet came along. We needed to protect people from surfing to things that initially were just the wrong categorizations, at least in my opinion. It was really to keep people focused on doing and looking up things that were business related. And there were some categories out there that were not deemed as business related. And therefore, that was really where the birth of the Secure Web Gateway came from. And at least that's my take. And I mean, Darren, I'll pinpoint you. What's your take?
Yeah, I was actually going to sort of jokingly say I remember back when the term not safe for work didn't exist. And, I think that was sort of the seeds planted for Secure Web Gateway. I agree with you. Back at the beginning of the internet, I actually think there's sort of a kind of a symbiotic relationship at the beginning between Secure Web Gateway and the moat model, right? So Secure Web Gateway ended up growing out of wanting to make sure that your users are going to the right place, that they have a little bit more protection for malware and a few other things, but controlling that outbound connectivity where they're going to predominantly the web, right? And in order to do that, you had to put them in a sort of a safe place, which meant you brought them back to your moat and then you let them go out. Because at the beginning, all of these were really prem-based solutions.
So let's talk about that. So there was really a few other technologies that were sort of relevant back in the day where internet speeds were less than optimal. I mean, we're talking T1 speeds up to 5 megs and so on and so forth. And you needed essentially a proxy to kind of help speed that up, caching and so on and so forth. Was that one of the areas that this started in or kind of evolved out of?
I would say yes. You're going to, I mean, that was one of the facilitating technologies, right? So you have a lot of things that are going on for secure web gateway. You're caching, you want to make sure you speed up the internet. To your point, I remember those days where you may have these huge farms of HA proxy trying to accelerate that experience. But naturally, you're going to have to protect what's coming in, right? Just from a corporate perspective. And truth be told, if you don't put some guide rails on the users that are coming from your corporate network and going out, eventually you're going to have somebody wandering off into the dark woods of the internet, pulling down some malware or going to a site they shouldn't go to. So there's a certain amount of self-preservation from an organization, but really keeping people safe in that compute environment.
I think it's worth pointing out that back then we were talking like half a meg circuits of meg circuits and also websites were plain text. I mean, there were no real graphics. There were no real images. I mean, and I remember at university I was when the internet kind of became a thing and you would sit there and you would watch a image load line by line, right? So, I mean... We're not talking the world we live in today where the youth of today are familiar with Netflix and YouTube. So it wasn't necessarily so much about bandwidth control. It was really more about making sure that if you went to the same site over and over and over, it was already there for you. It had already cached it because you knew that the 100 people or the 200 people in your organization were going to go to, I don't know, CNN or BBC News or the very few websites that actually existed. And also, I think it's worth noting that it was an on-prem service for people on-prem. There were very, very few people that were remote-based. It wasn't like the world we live in today. If you were remote-based, you generally had dial-up, for anyone that actually remembers that. You would dial up from your laptop with some form of dongle, and therefore it was almost like you were on-prem. And I like to consider that as the true zero trust. It was user to phone number generally, right? So the internet wasn't like it is today. And I mean, I know I'm aging myself by talking about that, but it was definitely a different world. And there were hardware appliances and proxies, right? So I know I'm talking a lot. So Ryan, anything you want to add?
No, I mean, I don't agree that modems were zero trust. We can split hairs on that one, but...
maybe we should go back to modems. I mean, that would slow everything down, right? the threat level would be like a little harder to get to.
Hard to steal all my data if you only have a 56K stream.
Exactly.
I would say I do agree the genesis of all this was the proxy, was the acceleration component. Back to your point, Jaye, the security components all came much, much, much later. Initially, it was about limited amount of control, as you mentioned at the beginning, but mostly it was about acceleration. I ran a proxy service and it was all about disk cache. That was the biggest thing we cared about, is like, how much disk cache do we have so that we can make best use of this tiny internet circuit. So in my experience anyway, that was the core.
All right, gentlemen. So we started off as a on-prem service, primarily with caching, a little bit of security. But I think there's also a lot of confusion around, why do I need a SWG when I already have a massive on-prem MGF firewall, NWGF firewall? What what are the differences between, say, what a SWG does and firewalls? And why do I need both, or do I need one or the other?
So I don't think we ever live in a time where firewalls aren't necessary to some degree. Maybe the role that they take and the overall security model might be different, but I kind of look at this a little bit like, you know, when you look at defense in depth, it's almost like the cool outerwear you might buy from Columbia, right? You have different layers that serve different functions. And so the more you can get the layers that match the environment you're going to be in or the function you're going to need, the better you're going to be. So think about, you know, you might need a Gore-Tex or a breathable waterproof liner, right? And so there's a specific use for that. And as the internet is sort of mushroomed, you see everything as web-based. I won't say everything, but a lot of things have become web-based. I think early 2000s, you really saw kind of this focus of if you can get it into some sort of HTTP, HTTPS format, you are going to be able to drive the usage of that application up. So as a result, once you've kind of sent your traffic into that kind of path, then you want a tool set that really helps, you know, kind of fit around that, whatever that might be, protection, malware detection, acceleration, all of those components. And a firewall just isn't suited for that, right? A firewall is really more about maintaining a border. Now, no doubt, next-gen firewalls got all kinds of functionality that have been slowly kind of coming into it, but you really can't take a general purpose device and say it's optimized for one thing, right? Those are contradicting ideas.
Yeah, agreed. I think the attack vectors have kind of changed. You think before we used to just block adult content, gambling, etc., and we trusted these news sites, but now can an on-premise firewall be up to date enough to pick out a new phishing website or another infiltration on a well-known website? So you need these more advanced cloud-based web gateways to be able to keep up to date.
Yeah, great point. Scale up, right? How are you going to scale up as your utilization scales up? With hardware, it's a much different proposition than just increasing your consumption in the cloud.
Yeah.
Would you also say that there's a bit of a scale problem with this? I mean, firewalls can't be everywhere, and then you're forcing that traffic to go back to an on-prem location. Although, you know, SWG is, its genesis is on-prem, but now certainly it's in the cloud.
I think that's maybe the shift we've seen with Secure Web Gateway. The way I see the progression is it was on-prem because everything was on-prem. The users were on-prem, their data was on-prem, devices were there. So why not have a Secure Web Gateway that was there, right? Like I said, there weren't that many people remote. So the ones that were remote, you backhauled into your secure or into your prem, and then they went out of your secure web gateway, right? Then the world started to change a little bit, and we had more remote users, or at least those remote users that were remote had better connectivity. You needed to be able to protect them, and you didn't necessarily want to backhaul because of the cost of internet circuits and because of all of those things. You were pretty much sending traffic down the same circuit to then send it back out again. So you started to put a secure web gateway on the client device, or at least point them to a cloud-based, initial cloud-based version. And a lot of the companies out there that had, they had an on-prem version and a cloud version. And depending on where you were, you would utilize one of those two. But then it went from just needing to protect against categorization or to categorize traffic to being able to deal with threats and malware and bad websites and what was a bad website, what was a good website, payloads. And what you don't want to do is you don't want to constantly download all of that data on-prem to then deal with it because you're utilizing those circuits. Why not move that significant performance to the cloud that you require? The cloud is designed to be able to do that and do it at scale. So why not send the traffic there? Because if your users are not on-prem, or there's a lot less of them today, and you need to do so much more, why not utilize the power of doing it somewhere rather than in a box? And that's kind of the journey I think we've gone on. And maybe I'm going to pick on you, Ryan, because I know your background is coming from a company that really redesigned Secure Web Gateway. Let's be honest, right?
Yep.
Do you see that the way I explained it with that transition from being like on-prem to being cloud-based happen for those reasons?
Yeah, I think the genesis of why Zscaler was so successful, and I would say Zscaler defined the market as we know it today. Maybe that's an unpopular attitude, but I think it's pretty accurate. Zscaler was the top right in the Gartner quadrant for like 10 straight years. I think the thing that they saw that no one else had seen yet was that distributed environments created a lot of cost around and complexity around hardware and managing that hardware. So if you only have one location, there's not a huge advantage of SWG in the 2016 era, 2017 era. But if you have 100 locations or 1,000 locations, there's a huge advantage because now all of these functions can be kind of delivered from the cloud instead of delivered from an edge where you have a hardware device that you need to patch and you need to maintain and you need to manage. So that was, I think, the first big innovation is like, hey, we can take all of these expensive firewalls and replace them with one less expensive, easier to manage cloud service. But I think what happened kind of 2018, 2019, 2020, certainly, is that we all went hybrid work, right? And that wasn't the thing that Zscaler saw when they kind of like modernized Web Gateway. And the remote work thing became a security nightmare for visibility. Right? Like my employee goes home and all of a sudden I have no idea what websites they're going to on this device, where my confidential data is going. And then all of a sudden, all of the other capabilities of being able to monitor that traffic 24/7 became much more valuable.
Yeah, I think especially around 2020, there was that event basically that we know many organizations, they needed a massive influx in increasing whatever solution they had. You had VPN, they just needed five times more VPN. And beyond creating, I think, a more acceptability of hybrid, it revealed a lot of problems in how traffic needed to flow. So when you're sending, you're backhauling your remote users to your prem so that you can have the visibility and the security tool set that, you know, admittedly lives there, your secure web gateways, your caching and what have you. It very quickly reveals that this is not the best way to route your traffic, especially for web traffic that's going to the web. The sooner you can get that traffic pointed at the web, the better your user experience is going to be. And let's face it, when you have cloud scale, which is probably not something that was truly available at the beginning of Zscaler, so it didn't have the advantage of working with that tool set, you're going to gain the ability to have visibility protect, but also optimize where you're going to let that traffic hit the internet so you can get closer to the service you're trying to get to faster.
So we had that event in 2020 that really kind of flipped the script on a lot of technologies, SWG, SSE, SASE, being other ones impacted by this. But now we're seeing, or at least there's conversations around return to work. I see the use case for SWG, you know, really helps out with remote work, hybrid work. But is campus and branch also a scenario that if you're a network architect or a security architect, should you be thinking about that as well? How do I take what I've done with my remote workforce and marry it to campus and branch and maybe start to sunset some of the other technologies that you've seen with on-prem?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I know, you know, Alex and Ryan probably have their own views on it, but the way I've seen it in the past is now that sort of the curtain is pulled back on the limitations of the older architectures, they were fine to get us here. But, you know, now that we've seen how traffic really wants to flow, if you will, this, I think, opens our eyes to maybe we don't need those gigantic firewalls with all of those additional modules put in there and being constrained by hardware type decisions. I think it makes a lot of sense really to send a lot of things into the cloud with, of course, the fact that there are just some optimizations you need that are prem-based. So this is where you might need to go site to site, or you might need some sort of optimization to go around some of the elements in a cloud. I don't think the model has really just been proven out, even for large scale, you know, premises, organizations, data centers. Data centers just add another element in there of, you know, wanting to do some additional security because you're on a premise and you might have the crown jewel sitting there.
Yeah, I think the thing that I see a lot, the customers are asking, they want consistency of user experience and security, no matter where the users are. They don't want to be managing two separate platforms for web filtering or secure web gateway on the firewall on premise, and they don't want to do that for a separate platform from the cloud. They want that user to go from remote to in the office and have the same level of security, the same level of experience. And that's a challenge. Yeah.
You're right on.
Yeah.
A network architect I know shared an interesting observation with, and not specifically about SWG, more about ZTNA in this context, but I think it ties into your question, John, which is one of the challenges of managing branch locations is not the internet security component, it's the rest of the branch network. It's the switching and the Wi-Fi and the NAC and patching all of that and maintaining it and owning it. And what's interesting is that if you adopt cloud-based solutions, you can just outsource that to the telco. The telco is going to provide you at a branch location with a Wi-Fi modem that has a switch built in, and you can kind of just use that for remote employees. And that shrinking of the managed surface significantly was something he saw as a benefit of like adopting this branch as a hybrid work environment.
So it's interesting on that. I remember, you know, way back in the dawn of the internet when I was working at Sun, the concept of should this be a core competency came up, right? It'd be a decision element. And I think as companies try to become more agile, faster, they're having to, you know, basically recognize some of these things don't need to be their core competency. And the more things you can put into the cloud where you have experts, vendor experts that are able to really produce an extremely high quality product, is the way to go for your own business.
I think user experience is critical to have the same look and feel wherever you are. We definitely live in a world where people are much more hybrid. And I know, and I've lived it, and I know that John has as well, where a user will be at home for 3 or 4 days a week. They'll then come in an office and their docking station doesn't work, their monitors doesn't work properly, they can't get their mouse working. That they want things to just be the same no matter where they are. But not only that, we as IT teams and security teams, we want visibility as well. We don't have to, we don't want to need to phone the user and go, I know you have a problem today, you can't get to the web, but where are you? So that I know what tool to look in. Are you at home? Are you using the at home secure web gateway? Or are you on prem? Do I look in my firewall logs? So it's about that look and feel being the same for the users and for us as security teams. But also we're seeing a real pivot towards the coffee shop kind of setup. We're seeing it so that, as Ryan was alluding to just now, with smaller branch offices, but we're also seeing it in bigger offices now where users just get internet access. I have the luxury of being on the road a lot and talking to a lot of prospects and customers. And what I'm hearing is, we don't have any on-prem stuff anymore. And don't get me wrong, there are still lots of use cases where you're going to have some legacy stuff on-prem. But if you're a relatively new company or you're opening a new site, people definitely start on the journey of, I don't want any hardware in my site other than something that connects me to the internet. As Ryan said, you want to reduce that complexity. So if you're treating users like a coffee shop or they're connecting like they are in a coffee shop, you want to make sure they have fast and efficient access and secure access. One of the customers I know that Alex is very familiar with working with at the moment is universities, right? So universities just give internet access. They have very, very little stuff on-prem and they just get internet access. And that's definitely the way people are going. And if you've got on-prem services and on-prem tools, you've got cloud-based services and cloud-based tools doing the same thing, it's really very complex, and you don't want that complexity, right? Alex, I don't know if there's anything you want to add around the kind of university use case.
Yeah, the university use cases seem to vary by some, because we've got universities in the UK that have students all around the world that need to access services out from the UK. But some of those countries don't allow those services. So they have to have a way of getting to those applications for those students without, you know, breaking laws, etc. But then we also in the UK, and it'd be interesting to see, I don't know if you have this in the US, there's the higher education, as we call them, or secondary schools, that have completely different use cases for Secure Web Gateway, how they want to secure the user's access, because, you know, we're treated as adults at university level, but secondary schools, you're treated as obviously children, which you are. So a lot of the services you would expect to get to completely blocked. And also this thing, law, I think we call it safeguarding in the UK, where we have to do things like keyword search. So if students are looking for, you know, harmful material or anything like that, we want to be alerted to that and to be able to support them where possible. So yeah, the use cases really do vary in the education space.
So let's dive into a little bit of that. You know, SWG was obviously started as on-prem. Bluecoat was kind of the big name in the industry. Zscaler flipped the script, put it into the cloud. And now we have this framework called SASE and as well a subset of that called SSE, where SWG is part of that. Result is lots and lots of vendors in this space. So I know all of you folks are on the road or are talking with folks out there that are looking into these solutions. They're kicking the tires on it. What are some of the pro tips that you might have when you're evaluating various vendors' functionality in the SWG space? Recommendations for people out there that are, you know, dipping their toe into this technology space or have an on-prem, are looking for cloud. What are some of the things that you need to be thinking about?
I would say from my perspective, the thing that I would consider earliest in your process is what capabilities you actually need and will actually add value. There's a lot of companies in this space that will say, oh, my, you know, feature ABC has this amazing capability that you absolutely need, but you maybe don't, right? And if you look at a feature comparison checklist, you know, Zscaler advertises all kinds of crazy stuff, the ability to control which web browsers your users surf from. Yes, that's a thing, but is that the most important thing? What are the core capabilities that you need to be successful?
Yeah.
And I think also compared to what you have today, you know, don't necessarily feel the need to use this as a way to make a full 10x shift in capabilities. If all you have today is like DNS-based filtering, you know, any improvement on that is a positive improvement in terms of user experience, consistency, additional, you know, inspection, SSL decrypt, that kind of stuff. You don't necessarily need to have the best of everything in every category. Look for, you know, what's that balance of capabilities that enhance your security in the ways that are valuable to you. You know, honestly, one of the things that I hear a lot from folks about SWG is just from a SecOps perspective, having all the logs in one place and easy to view is a huge advantage in terms of completing investigations faster. And maybe that's enough, like, you know, going from DNS filtering to decrypt, you know, adding some basic malware inspection and getting centralized logs and faster investigations, that might be enough. So don't, you know, fall in the trap of like, oh, look at all the fancy DLP features. If you don't have a clear DLP vision and goal of what you need to achieve, that's going to be a huge waste of time and money. So I would say that's my tip, is start from where you are and where do you want to get to realistically, and then evaluate the offerings.
I think I'd like to add a little bit onto that. I mean, we're talking about SWG, but it is part of the wider kind of SSE and SASE framework. And I totally agree with what you said, Ryan, in regards to you don't need every feature to do everything. If you have an on-prem solution today, it's going to be relatively basic. What do you need it to do moving forward? And then where can you branch out into regards to the wider SSE or SASE portfolio? Most people are going to have some kind of VPN where ZTNA sits in. They're going to have some form of DLP, CASB. They're going to have all those other elements probably already in play today. They may have elements of them on their firewall. They may have elements from other vendors. If you're starting your journey with Secure Web Gateway, fine. Do exactly what Ryan said. Investigate where you need to go. But then everybody I'm speaking to, every CISO or CIO I'm speaking to, is talking about consolidation, getting more bang for your buck, being able to have one throat to choke. It was something that I always wanted to do, and it wasn't necessarily that easy to do that like 10 years ago. There were people that were very, very good at Secure Web Gateway. There were people that were very, very good at CASB. So you really had to go down different routes. It's a bit like cars. I mean, I have a two-seater sports car. It's not going to be any use driving my kids to school in it, right? So, but you can now buy fast four-seater sports cars in theory, right? So it's the same concept. It's what is the longer-term goal? Make sure you look outside of your Secure Web Gateway and see what's coming next. And I'm sure we're going to talk about where we think SSE and SASE are going next anyway. But Darren and Alex, sorry, I jumped in. I don't know if there's anything you want to add.
No, actually, I really agree with that. I think one of the, even though we're talking about SWG today, there's this other movement that's going on around remote access. So we've talked about VPN. Sorry, I'm playing dodge the sun here a little bit. We're talking about ZTNA more and more as a VPN replacement. And if you really look, at least for the customers that I've worked with, there's a natural kind of overlap between what you want to do with ZTNA and what you want to do with SWG. It kind of makes a lot of sense to start thinking about them at the same time. And when you, you know, kind of have that recognition, that moment of recognition, having a single tool, platform, if you will, to keep control of, you know, your VPN users and get visibility for your VPN users, have that single point for debugging, troubleshooting, visibility for security, it really starts compounding and amplifying. So I would say, even though you might start your journey with Secure Web Gateway, or potentially you've already started your journey with ZTNA, it makes sense to think about these tools merging together in a way that wouldn't have been possible before.
Yeah, agreed. I've been surprised how basic some of the requirements are from a Secure Web Gateway capability. And some of the niche use cases I have seen, though, being things like customization of categories, basic things like that, being able to allow, they have, I mean, local councils in the UK, we have some strange use cases where they want some users that can go to certain websites you wouldn't fully expect them to. So being able to very quickly identify those users and be allow it, rather than what you'd normally see with, you know, if we go back to the firewall branch story, is every user was blocked for that. You couldn't really do that per user policy. So being able to do those niche use cases as well. And also, I think the last thing I would say was from a, you know, don't always trust the a category just because it's a trusted category like a news site. It could still have some, you know, malware or something else on that site and that content. So you need the capabilities of the platform to secure it.
All right. So we've kind of established that as you look at SWG, you need to kind of think about it in the larger framework of SASE, SSE. Given that there's so many vendors out there, let's talk a little bit about test drive. How do you kick the tires on this technology? What are the top, say, three things that you should be testing to make sure that this technology or vendor's technology fits your requirements?
My top tip is actually use it full time.
You have to use it full time.
Don't, and as someone who runs POCs for a living, a lot of people will like turn their solution on to test feature A, feature B, feature C. Functional testing is easy. Anyone can do that with SWG. Turn it on full time for all your traffic and see what breaks. See, is the user experience actually good or is it terrible? You know, what they promised me in the glossy PowerPoint, is that what I'm actually getting? Does SSL decrypt break a bunch of my applications? And if it does, how easy is it to troubleshoot that? How easy is it to kind of make this configuration work for me? That's the main tip that I have in terms of test drive, is just actually use it. Don't just do functional testing.
I think you're probably right. And I know you have to leave soon, so thank you for coming on. But you're exactly right. I think the situation is, I'm going to go back to the car analogy. I'm sorry. if I mean, there's very difference between going and sitting in a car at the garage and just putting the windows up and down and opening, closing the doors and going, yeah, it's perfect. You actually need to start the engine, or if it's electric, don't start the engine. You actually should go for a drive, have it for a weekend, have it for a few hours at least. Actually, like, get in and get involved. It's not the same as if you take two users or five users and you run it for an hour. In my opinion, that doesn't do what you need. And I'm not saying if you're a 10,000 user customer or 10,000 user company, you can necessarily try all 10,000 users. But you do need a very rigorous test plan. You need to test all the things that you need from the product. So firstly, to go back to a previous question, John, make sure you list out exactly what you need and why, yeah. And then test exactly what you need and why. Because once you drive that car out of the garage, if it doesn't turn left and you can only turn right, you're going to have a problem, right? Again, Ryan, yeah, NASCAR, for coming on.
Yeah, no worries. I want to agree with what you were saying there. It's exactly the right analogy of sitting in the lot versus actually driving it. But again, if you're going to drive off-road, test drive off-road, right? Like, this is the real advice. Anyway, appreciate being included. Apologies that I have to leave before we're wrapped here, but I have another commitment coming up in 3 minutes. We'll talk all soon.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ryan.
Cheers, man.
All right, so let's dive into the futures in the last few minutes that we have here. So this technology part of the framework, there's a lot of convergence going on. It's being pushed into the background of some of those technologies. What is the future of SWG? Will it stand alone as its functionality, or will more and more of the SASE framework, or even items that are not even in the SASE framework, start to merge into the SWG technology? Because it is kind of that technology that is outwardly facing and protecting the company. And I can think of some categories that I can see merging into it, but let's reach out here to our experts.
I agree wholeheartedly. Prior to, you know, my current employer, I didn't have a huge amount of experience with some of these SSE technologies, and I think that gives me an interesting perspective. And what I learned is exactly what you're talking to. You can think of private versus public kind of destinations. And when you think of the world that way, Secure Web Gateway and CASB start merging together, right? They kind of start looking like they have extremely similar functions. Now, the specific destination might be a little different, but you know, you're doing a lot of the same things because you're sending users out to the internet. You want to protect them. You want visibility. You want to control data, make sure nothing is sneaking off. I think the future is that they're going to start becoming one in the same.
Yeah, I think I'm not hearing any customers talk about separate solutions anymore. Maybe it worked for a SASE vendor, but they're generally talking about consolidation. And that's just not just consolidation of like the CASB and the SWG capability, but that's cloud firewall. You know, it's maybe removing on-premise firewalls and moving that to the cloud. And being able to see, like Ryan said, everything in one platform makes such a big difference from a audit reporting perspective and security.
I think we've been striving for consolidation for as long as I've worked in IT. And it's something that we've always wanted. We've always wanted the smallest number of tools from the smallest number of vendors we could possibly have. And there are reasons for that, right? You can negotiate better deals if you get from a single vendor. There's only one throat to choke. If you have a problem, you know where you're going and you don't have the vendor ping pong. It's not my problem, it's their problem. And for a long, long period of time, we couldn't get that consolidation because somebody was very, very good at Secure Web Gateway and the rest didn't quite meet the need, or very, very good at CASB and the rest didn't quite meet the need, or switching or whatever. Let's look at any technology. I think technology's been around long enough now to be able to get 90% of what you need consolidated. And in a world that we live in today, with budgets being tight and things being complex and there being more tools than we've ever had, consolidation is at the top of everyone's mind that I speak to. And I know John feels the same. And consolidation is now finally achievable. And I think Gartner have done really well when they talk about the SSE architecture and the SASE architecture, because that's forced the big technology companies to go on a journey they may well not have gone on if it wasn't for that. And now Gartner are talking about universal ZTNA, i.e. widening that SASE architecture to include the on-prem elements like microsegmentation and NAC, because that's one of the things that if you look at the SASE architecture, it's not really there. And the reason for that, at least in my opinion, is because when that architecture came about, we were not living as hybrid as we are today. Most of the users were still at home, etc. So I think we will consolidate SSE. We will then consolidate more towards SASE and even wider. There'll be more and more consolidation. Yes, there will be new technologies come along. We could talk about EDR and XDR. Does that get consolidated into the same agent that you're using for your ZTNA or your SWG? Where does that go? And John, you can give your opinion on that. But we're definitely going to move in that more consolidated kind of market and towards single technologies. I think we're definitely there when it comes to secure web gateway anyway. The features of CASB and DLP are already part of your standard secure web gateway. You didn't really buy them independently 5 years ago like you used to. You're now adding on more functionality, and it's just going to grow from there, right? And John, I can tell you're dying to say something.
There's so many things I want to say, but we don't have a lot of time. But I think the key point here is one of those pro tips. As you look to evaluate SWG, think about it as part of the larger framework. See where you can consolidate. See if, you know, does CASB play into that vendor's SWG? Does DLP play into it? To what extent? And to take Ryan's pro tip as well, look at it in terms of your use cases. Don't try to boil the ocean with all the buzzwords and acronym salad that vendors will throw at you. Really look at it in terms of what you need and the business outcomes that you can expect to achieve from this technology. And then the final thought is, I think Jaye and everyone else has just kind of pointed out maybe the next episode for the SSE Forum Live, and that's the great ongoing debate around platforms versus portfolios versus point products. So maybe that's what we dive into next time, Jaye.
I think that sounds like fun. I'd like to thank Alex for coming on and Darren for coming on and obviously Ryan for coming on. It's very good to have people come on that are actually in the field on a day-to-day basis, seeing what's going on and understanding what customers need. And it's appreciated to give up your time. So thank you very much.
Yes, guys. And John, I've seen Jaye now eat pineapple and pizza, but not together yet, but it's getting closer.
Oh, so we're getting close. That could happen at RSA and maybe we can get Jaye and Chase in his superhero Dr. Zero Trust outfit to do that together. That would be outstandingly amazing.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you very much for another episode of SSE Forum Live. That's the best.